Oh, champ.
Tired.
Tired. Tired? Hey, how can you be tired? I heard you were on the radio this morning, weren't you?
Yeah. Yeah, I bet it was 6:30 a.m. I don't even get out of bed on a daily basis until like 9 o'clock. Yeah. So, this is early bullshit. It's not cool.
Nice. Is everybody ready? Hey, you know what, DJ? Before we get started on your fight, I'm actually just really curious what your thoughts are on the way the Chris Weidman fight ended, with Gegard getting that TKO.
You know, it's unfortunate, but as an athlete, we always go over the rules before the fight. And I've had the same similar case when I fought John Dodson the very first time. He was playing that game. If you're gonna play that game, you're just asking for trouble. And I think when Chris Weidman said, you know, I purposely put my hands down so you wouldn't need me, you have to take a look back at this sport of mixed martial arts that if a man could put both his hands down on the ground and stop my actions to progress to finish them, you gotta take a look at this. You gotta take a look at the rules. You know, I think it's a stupid rule. I think Pride and Dream had it correctly. You can knee people in the head if they're down like that. Mm-hmm. There's a simple way you can avoid that. A true down person is somebody's gonna put a knee down, okay? But a person's gonna put his knee down because you can take advantage of it, take the back and all that stuff. But it's unfortunate, man. It's you're playing with fire when you play that role. And Big John McCarthy, each time I fight, he tells me, he goes, if you put your hand down, you're not a down opponent. If you're gonna play that game, be expected to get kneed in the head. So, you know. And I like Chris Weidman. There's nothing against him at all. I'm just saying, like, you're playing with fire when you're doing that. So.
And it's tricky too because the situation
fire
is they,
chicken.
Yeah, they think it's illegal, but then he actually wanted to continue fighting. I mean, so that at the end of the day, I mean, it's just if you were Gegard, how would you feel about getting that win that way?
Well, like Gegard said, a win's a win. You know, he's in his full check, and good for him, it was last fight in his deal, so he has all the arguing power. I mean, Gegard Mousasi is a legit middleweight. I think he could be the middleweight champion of the world. You know, I think if he became the middleweight champion of the world, him and Jacare would fight over again. And you just look at Gegard's complete game. He's got great stand-up. Every single time Chris Weidman took him down, he was able to elevate him, get back up to his feet, and Chris Weidman wasn't able to land a lot of damaging blows, even though you had him full mount. So, Gegard's legit, man. I mean, fouls the cup, and now pay him what he wants.
Let's talk about you, Demetrious. I mean, here you are standing on the cusp of history. You've been open about it. I mean, you've said all along, this is where I want to be. First of all, talk about how it feels to now really be on the edge of tying that long-standing record.
It feels good. I mean, at the same time, you know, it's just another fight. And it feels good to be there, and hopefully I go out there and be successful and make it happen.
I wonder, you know, to set those lofty goals. I mean, is that hard to do? You know, something that people have been unable to match. I mean, was that hard along the way to set something that high?
I don't want to say. I mean, don't get me wrong. When I first became a champion, it was like we're going for number 10. Well, I don't know what it was at that time, but it was like we're going for 10. You know, it was just, you know, get through this championship fight. And now, as I get older, it's about getting through the training camps, because as you get older, and you know, I don't take any supplements, no HGH, no testosterone, no steroids bullshit. You know, your body does not recover like it used to. You know, and I have always heard older fighters when I was 23, 24, they're like, oh man, my body's coming. I'm like, yeah, whatever. But as I get older, I realize it's true. It doesn't really bounce back like it usually does. So for me, it's one fight at a time, one camp at a time, and one defense at a time. So if I'm not successful this Saturday, same thing. I'm like, all right, let's see if we can break it. Now we tied it, let's see if we can break it. And then after that, I'm like, shit, let's see if we can do 12 and 13, 14. And I'm like, hey, I want to pay you to go 35. Okay, let's go into negotiations. And then if I don't like negotiations, I'll go back down 25. So, I mean, at the end of the day, I'm just focused on one fight at a time.
You want to get to 11 before you start considering the possibility? Because you always said you wanted to get the record. So do you want to get to 11?
Oh,
you
start
talking about 35?
Yeah, 10's just a stepping stone. It's the ultimate goal is 11. I mean, it's like Floyd Mayweather. When he got 49-0, it's like, why would you stop there? Like, you can easily go to 50-0 and be the only fighter to ever do it. No, I'm going past. My goal is to go past 10. So, but, you know, let's say I go out there Saturday and I'm not successful. I've far exceeded my expectations to when I got into the sport. Far, I mean, you got to think. You hear these fighters all the time. I was destined to do this. It's my destiny. How the fuck do you know what your destiny is? You're only 25 years old. You don't even have kids. Like, so for me, like, for me to see it, like, oh, it was my destiny to be the champion and do this. No, it wasn't. I don't even know what my destiny is. You know, I was put on this earth to be a good man and to raise beautiful children and have a beautiful wife. And hopefully, you know, I don't know, maybe I was destined to have an ugly ass wife. I don't know. So when people talk about this destiny stuff, I'm just like, okay, that's their film. So for me, when I got into sport, I was just a fan of martial arts and working a full-time job and training and doing amateur fights just on the weekend just because it reminded me of being in high school and wrestling again. And then to be able to become a world champion, you know, like I said, man, I was the guy who was carrying, you know, construction tubes, trying to go home after the training to see Joseph Benavidez fight in Uriah Faber's fight. And here I am. I've got the belt. So, I far exceeded my expectations. I'm very happy with my career, and I'm looking forward to keep on building more things to be exceed my expectation. So
I want to ask you about Wilson Reis. I mean, a lot of people, of course, I mean, you've beaten everybody in the division, so a lot of people are like, Wilson Reis. But I wonder if this fight was important to you simply because you kind of owed it to him a little bit. I mean, did you feel like a sense of, like, I got to give him the shot because he had it before?
No, I don't owe anybody anything. You know, people call me for interviews. Hey, I want to do an interview with you. I'm like, I don't have to do an interview with you. I truly don't. I don't have to. So I didn't feel like I owe this to him. I feel like he earned it. You know, I feel that he's been on a hot streak. He's the only guy who's in the top three. Or what is he now? Top four? He hasn't got a title shot yet. So, yeah, I mean, the UFC called and said, hey, this is what we're thinking. I'm like, yeah, sounds good, you know. And here we are.
The other thing I want to ask you about was when people say there's no competition for you.
That's the stupidest thing. Then you throw in a boat of Daniel Cormier. He has no competition. Because you look at it, you know, he's already beat Oscar Gustafsson, which is ranked number two, I believe, right? He just beat, Anthony Johnson for a second time. Anthony Johnson just beat Oscar Gustafsson, knocked out Jimmy Manoa. And then he also beat Glover Teixeira. Jimmy Manoa sitting there thinking that he's going to be able to knock out Daniel Cormier to where if you're thinking that it's going to take one punch to knock him out, you might be chance, but there's that, obviously everybody has a puncher's chance, but you're going into that fight with one mindset that I just need to hit him to where, I'm sorry, my friend, you're going to need more than just a hit to beat him. So you look at the landscape of the light heavyweight division, until DC and John Jones fight again, that's the ultimate goal. So I think Daniel Cormier still has competition because, yes, any one of those guys could knock him out. You know what I mean? They gotta do it. So in my division, you have a lot of new up-and-comers. You have a lot of fresh blood that I have not fought yet. A lot of guys who have O's against their record. So I'm looking to just keep on fighting and see how well I can do. See if I can put some more, you know, take away some of the O's.
Well, I wonder if you kind of feel it's disrespectful. You know, I feel like for people to say there's no competition, it's almost disrespecting the fact that you've been able to put yourself above everybody.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the guys that I fought in our division. You have Joseph Benavidez. He's an absolute killer. He's only lost four times in his whole time mixed martial arts career. And then after that, you would have Dotson if you wanted to cut down to 25, but I don't blame him. It's a hard cut. And then you have just killer after killer. And they just say it's you know, no competition. It's like saying being disrespectful to Usain Bolt. There's no competition for you, man. You're the fastest man on the planet. He goes, so as an athlete, you don't look at that. That's what the fan, the public says. That's what they say. I don't look at that. I go out there and I compete and I do my job and that's it.
Well, by the flip side of that is them having to make a whole season of The Ultimate Fighter to find people for you is actually incredibly complimentary. Saying we need to search every corner of the world to find a dude, you know, to as good as DJ.
Yeah, I mean, you had guys like Hiromasa from Japan. You had guys from Brazil. I mean, you literally had every guy from, you know, smaller organizations, Legacy Fighting, Titan, all these guys come from, their champions come and fight, you know, and they're still signing new guys. You know, there's a lot of guys who weren't in that tournament that were champions in other organizations around the world. So, yeah, I mean, like I said, it's a compliment, but for me, as an athlete, you stay focused and you keep your eye on the prize.
What did you make of that fight with Tim Elliott?
Me, Tim fight?
Yeah.
Oh, he's very tough. We knew that going into the fight that he's very tough, very greedy, very big for the weight class, very long. And, you know, when he fought Joseph Benavidez, I mean, he was taking Joseph down multiple times. And then finally Joseph, you know, caught him in that choke and was able to secure it. But he's a tough, greedy guy. And then I'm glad to have fights like that because as an athlete, you need to go through adversity. Like a lot of people, like when I look back and look at the fight, it was a good fight to have, you know. The first round was a little bumpy, then after that it was like, okay, you know, we know what he's gonna do, just grapple. You shoot a takedown, he's gonna go for the choke, pass guard, and you're good to go.
It's kind of like when John was going deep with Alexander Gustafsson. Everybody knew how good John was. He finished fights earlier before. There was something really appealing about watching him dig that deep. Is that what you mean? That sort of kind of going through that?
No, for me, it's just that you, as a person, you know, there's sometimes when you know, I've done many sports, cross country, track, and when you're running cross country, you got to run, you know, 5K, and you're running against guys who are taller. Nobody's shorter than me in 5K and cross country, but you're running against guys and you can hear them breathing, you can hear them pushing, and then when it comes down to, you know, the last 800 meters, then you start to see whose balls are bigger, who's gonna start their kick and keep on kicking, and then that guy's still with you and his strides getting longer, and it's like, okay, he's still pushing, okay, can I push a little bit more? I kind of felt that with the Tim Elliott fight, to where he just kept on moving. I mean, I don't know how many times I got hit in the back of the head. I don't even know how many times I got kneed when I was behind him, when he's just like, knee me. I'm just like, pretty sure that's illegal, but I don't care, because it's whatever. So it's good to go to those gritty fights, because as a champion and as an athlete, you need those, because it just lets you know, reassures you that you can. I mean, Tim Elliott's a bigger dude than me. He's way bigger than I am, and to be able to push like that against a guy who's gritty, like I'm happy to have him as an opponent under my record.
Was he the toughest challenge lately for you then?
Lately. Man, it's hard to say, because when I look at a challenge, I would say his unpredictability was the biggest challenge. It wasn't, and him being a bigger body, that was the challenge. So yeah, you could say it was a challenge, but like a guy like, I mean, I still say Dominic Cruz and John Dodson were my biggest challenge, because Dominic Cruz can do everything. He can mix it up, he can wrestle, he has good footwork, he has good angles. He's also bigger, you know, I'm 5'3", he's 5'10". And him doing this and reaching back and throwing that punch, it's always hard to dodge. And he had that one punch knockout. Like, all he needs to do is touch you, and you're going to sleep. So, but the thing that, you know, Tim Elliott has that Dodson doesn't have is that he has that grit, that push, that pace. So every single person I fight, they always presented a challenge to me. Tim Elliott just had that. I'm going to fight you. Like, I'm going to be there the whole entire time and be in good condition. So,
Demetrious, a couple weeks ago, Cody Garbrandt threw out the idea of going down to 125 and being your 11th title challenger. Usually people talk about you going up to 135. Did, any thoughts on,
no.
On that?
No, not at all. I mean, it's not the first time somebody's not said that. You know, a lot of people say that they can make the weight class. Shit, I can make 115 pounds if they want to throw the division out there. Would I be able to perform at my ability? Probably not. But yeah, that's fine. If he wants to come down and the UFC wants to give him immediate title shots, because that's what they do nowadays, you get immediate title shots, then that's fine. Or if I go up and fight him, challenge him for his belt, you know, if the negotiations go well, then yeah, it could happen. So it's a fight. It's a fight.
Would you be able to do it
either way? Yeah. I mean, I've never turned anybody down from coming to my weight class to challenge for my belt. Like, I've never done it, and it's not going to start now, and it's never going to happen. I mean, if Josie Aldo says, I can make 125 pounds, Demetrious Johnson, I'm coming down to fight you and me. I'm like, sweet, perfect, let's get you, let's get down to that weight class and let's make it happen. So, I mean, like I said, a lot of people have just said that before, and I'm still here.
Demetrious, I wonder, you know, you talk about, this might be the greatest accomplishment in MMA. 10 consecutive title defenses, a few accomplishments, amazing. You got a guy like Conor McGregor, two belts, never defended either one of them. He's sitting on the verge of maybe a $100 million payday. Mm-hmm. How do you justify that in your head, and how does it affect you? Because I'm sure you would appreciate a payday like that to set your family up for the rest of your life.
Y'all would never see me fucking again. no, you guys would.
Destiny would, all day.
Yeah, destiny would. You know, it's so hard to sing about this sport. It truly is, because it's always about, I don't want to say drama, but it's about the big stars. I mean, let's just go back to Gegard Mousasi. He brought up a great point. You know, he's like, you know, why is Mark Hunt, Michael Bisping, and all these guys getting paid more? Okay, Michael Bisping is the champion. Okay, Mark Hunt, he's a very big, lot of following. But Gegard's beat Mark Hunt. He's beat Jacare before, but it's 1-1, so it's even. He's beat Dan Henderson. Dan Henderson makes a lot of money. So then, for me, it's all about just keeping it real. So if he came out and said, it goes, dude, why is this person making all this money and I'm not? And then the UFC come out and goes, okay, well, Gegard, the reason why Mark Hunt's making all this money and you're not is because he sells way more tickets than you do and X, Y, and Z. And he goes, but I beat him. And he goes, yeah, that's okay. I mean, there's been guys who've made more money than me, and I've had way more fights in the UFC than they have. And then they just sell more. So you have to look at it as, you know, Conor's done a lot of amazing things. You know, he's a two-weight champion. He's a champ, whatever you want to call it. And now he's on the verge of going out and fighting Floyd Mayweather, first box in MMA. And he's probably going to make the biggest pay in his life for his first professional box because it's going to bring so many eyes, right? So that's what it's about. It's about the eyes. For me, does it put a bad taste in my mouth that this belt should be worn in way more bigger paychecks? Absolutely does put a bad taste in my mouth. If I sit here and be like, absolutely not, it doesn't, blah, 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 we fucking lie to you guys. But I believe the champions, out of all ticket sales or anything like that, they should get paid the most. And the champions might not bring in the most ticket sales and pay-per-view buys and all that stuff. But I still think if you weren't a gold, you should be getting, you know, the biggest paychecks. It'd be middleweight. How many champions are in the UFC now? 18? Count the interim champions now, too. Count the interim champions. So how many champions are? 18 guys. All 18 of those guys should be on top of the pay list. And after that, you can start doing the ticket sales because you got to make this feel people want it. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, obviously, I'm one. I've been defending it for so damn long. But like to me, this is my love. This is what it symbolizes me. This is what makes me keep on fighting. But other guys, they can just sport like, you know what? I don't even need to become a champion. All I do is got to talk a lot of shit, sell a lot.
So do you ever have that conversation and think like, no, I need to talk some more shit?
No, because like, it's not my personality. It's truly not. Like, somebody asked me the other day, I'm driving. They're like, yo, dog, I heard somebody say they're coming out of your weight class. What do you think of it? I'm like, getting gas. Talk to you later. Like, I just don't, I mean, it's just not in my bone. You know what I mean? Like, you get me playing video games, I'm a totally different character. Totally different character. Like, you know, I drop down and the guy goes, I'm going to kill you, N-word. I'm like, ah, we'll see about it, mother effer. And I'll get a gun and I'll light him up. Like, yeah, call me N-word, aren't ya? Did it work out good for you? Now that, you know, I'm talking stuff, but that's in the virtual for me. I'm a non-controversial person, never have been in my life, so why would I start now? You know what I mean? It's just, if like Gegard said, if it's not the person you are, don't try to be it, you know? I feel like that's some people's thing, you know? DC, when he was yapping, I'm like, ew, I'm like, you look like you're a total dumbass right now. To me, but I'm pretty sure someone on the other side of the tube is like, yeah, look good, yeah, well, look, you talk shit to John Jones, like, let's be honest, dude. If John Joe's got in that fucking cage, you might not be walking out with the gold. You know what I mean? Like Snoop Dogg said, Skinny Bone Jones gonna whoop your motherfucking ass. I'm gonna walk him out with him. You know what I mean? So, but a DC guy out there, he goes, you know, thank you guys so much. I truly appreciate it. Anthony Johnson, you're an amazing athlete. I'm so glad I could share the octagon with you two times. Jim Minn was out there. I know he packs a great punch. I'm looking to get in there and mix it up with him. And he turns around, and you know, I see John Bones Jones, the former, you know, UFC light heavyweight champion of the world. I see him out there. Once he gets his, you know, his stuff cleared up, I'm looking forward to getting in there and mixing up with him too. And, you know, thank you guys so much for tuning into this fight. Totally calm, professional. Everybody was like, well, that was fucking boring. You know what I mean? But he... Mrs. Lancome. But it's just what society has brought upon the
He's
sport of mixed
martial arts. He's a huge pro wrestling fan.
He is a huge pro wrestling fan. Exactly, yeah. I don't watch wrestling, so... So that's what I mean. Like that, there's two sides of it. So when you... And that's what, like, people are coming out being more just vocal nowadays. Yeah. So, but for me, it's not in my character.
But you are more vocal than you used to be back in the day. You definitely have evolved in that game.
Yeah, I evolved in that game, but never in the words of shit-talking or, like, just, like, you know, if somebody said they're going to do something, okay. You know, I told my wife, I'm like, that's like me going to a club with you and saying, yo, dude, I'm going to take a girl home and fuck her. I'm like, good luck.
But there's something to be said for the argument of watching, you know, when you look at Conor and he's got the Rolls Royce and the glasses and the Gucci business, there's something to be said for fans buying into that champ lifestyle and you guys selling that mystique and everything. Like, there's something to be said for not always being a nice guy and not always being a good guy because you are the baddest. You know what I'm saying? So there's balance here.
I like the balance of like James Bond or Batman. You know, nobody knows who Batman is, essentially. Nobody knows who Bruce Wayne is. And he goes on about his life, and when the bat thing shows him in the sky, he goes off, and he puts his mask on, and he goes to sing. Have you guys watched One Punch Man? It's an anime about the strongest spider in the world, and he beats all his opponents by one... Yeah, right? I just finished that season. It's amazing, and I almost kind of like, I fell in love with it because he's the strongest hero in the world, but nobody knows who he is, and he'll be fighting somebody, and the guy's like, "Oh, I am the and he goes, "Okay," and then he was like, "Oh, I see you don't care," and then he goes, "No, I actually got to go to the market and get something done. Are we gonna fight?" Then he punches the guy, and the guy explodes. And then he goes about his way. But his demeanor about things is that nobody knows who he is, you know? I mean, there is that mystic thing to where kids, they look up and they're like, "Oh, I want to be like that one, the flashy cars and all that stuff." But I've met so many professional athletes. I met a guy who was a football player, and he goes, "I wish I could have been a doctor." It's like, wait, what? Why? He goes, and I told him, I was like, "Dude, you make a shitload of money." He goes, "Yeah, but I have to deal with the media. I have to, you know, worry about my the next guy coming to beat me and my weight." Also, he was a football player. All this stuff. I wish I'd been a doctor. But you know, I wanted to get to the high life, so I saw these guys with the flashy cars. I'd rather be the true staple, the light. I don't want to sound like a fucking religious. I'd rather be a true person where it's like, "Man, you're the UFC world champion, man. You must got bitches all over you. You sniff cocaine, you get the high life. You got on Rolls Royce, you got..." Like, I have none. No, I do not do cocaine or drugs. I'm going home. I'm not going to a club tonight. I'm going home. I'm going to put my kids to bed. And I'm a good fighter.
Are you just a more secure person then?
I'm
not trying to say these other people are insecure.
Yeah.
But I mean, is that, have you always been that way?
I've always been that way. Yeah. Even in high school, when it came to wrestling tournaments, boys be out there partying Saturday night. I'll stop by the party after I'm done my wrestling tournament, say what's up to my friends, jump in the car, drive home. That's how I've always been. I don't go out. If I'm, me and Destiny are going out to dinner or a bar, we go, "Okay, who's drinking tonight? All right, you're going to drink? Perfect." I don't even have a sip of alcohol because I just not going to put myself in that situation. You know, guys, go out, I'm pretty sure I can have one beer and drive home. But why would I risk that? I'm not going to do that. You know what I mean? Like,
so all this time that we're saying, like, why isn't he a bigger star? Are you saying you kind of enjoy the anonymity a little bit?
No, I'm not saying that. Like, I was at the airport yesterday, and I was charging my Nintendo Switch. And nobody was bothering me. And the guy comes up and he goes, "Must be nice, nobody knows who you are, huh?" And I was like, "What's up?" And he goes, "Oh, I'm shocked people aren't just swarming me right now." I'm like, "Why would they swarm me?" "Because you're the fucking champion." I was like, "So?" And then he goes, "Oh, it just must be nice." I'm like, "Yeah, it does feel nice to be able to go to the store." And, you know, and don't get me wrong, if I go out, people know who I am. And they're like, "Oh, man, hey, what's going on? This is Junior. Say hello to Junior." And I'm like, "Hey, what's up, Junior?" And I take time for I take time for children all the time, you know. When I was at the UFC 209 supporting Tyron Woodley, you know, all these people were like, "Come on out here." And I've been up since fucking 5 a.m. in the morning to do meetings and stuff. And I was like, I walked out there and I was like, "Are there any children out here?" And all the children ran up, took care of their children. I'm like, "Thanks, guys. Have a good night." And then this one guy goes, "You're such an asshole. You can do it." I'm like, "You're an adult. Go watch porn and you'll forget about it."
Do we value this belt more than you do then, DJ? Like, you know what I mean?
No.
We know you don't value it, but at least are we worried about the trappings of it way more than you are?
What do you mean by trappings?
Well, just all the stuff that's supposed to come with it and all the ways you're supposed
I think people think with a belt a lot more stuff's supposed to come with it. A lot more stuff to come with it. I remember one person says, "There's a lot of responsibility when you're the champion." I'm like, "No, there's not." You name me five responsibilities as a champion
that you didn't have as just
as a regular fighter.
You have to go represent the company, DJ.
I've already done that when I was a fighter.
John had that situation. Yeah. He was a champ. He did something bad, and he got stripped from it. So there is a.
A moral flaw.
But still, if I wasn't a champion, I'd go on and I do that stuff. Still, me looking at this. Here's a good example. Perfect example, right? So, let's say that, I don't want to go there because then I'm going to put myself in a hole.
Say it.
Yeah, so here we go, right? There's a lot of controversy on what was going on in the politics, right?
Yeah.
Now, if I was to go out there and give my honest true opinion, just say what I thought, and I was not the champion, I didn't even fight for the UFC. Right. People are like, "Oh, it's just another say-so person with blah, 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 blah." Here we go. I was streaming on Twitch, and this guy goes, "Hey, DJ, I'm 5'9 and 140 pounds. Am I skinny?" And I go, "The fuck's that supposed to mean? How the fuck am I supposed to know?" And all people goes, "Oh, you should answer that way more proper. Like, oh, you know, you're 145 pounds, you know, 5'9", you're okay, man. Don't worry about it. But I answered truthfully. So when people are like, there's a lot more responsibility that comes with this belt, I truly don't believe that's true. I believe that when I was a champion and when I wasn't a champion, I still have the same responsibility. Be a good person. Don't go out there, commit crimes and do drugs and fail drug tests and miss weight, you know. And even as I'm champion, the thing still stays the same. You know, people might put me on a pedestal higher, like, you should not be doing this stuff, but at the same time, shouldn't be doing this shit in the first place, whether I was champion or if I wasn't even fighting the UFC. So that's when people, like, put this stuff, like, when they're like, I just laughed at somebody. He goes, this, you know, he was like, he works for the UFC. He goes, there's a lot of stuff that comes with, you know, being a champion. I'm like, fucking what? Please tell me, please send me the paragraph that I need to know as a champion. Like, as far as I'm concerned, my job is to do media, make weight, fight, and win. Four responsibilities. Please tell me if I'm missing anything or I should add more to this list. Because if I need to, then I've been doing this for 2012, 2017. Let me know if I need anything else. As far as I'm concerned, all Karyn needs to do is fight, win, make weight, do media. That's all he needs to do.
I mean, you've been talking for 20 minutes and I haven't asked about Wilson much.
That's fine.
Break him down for us. What do you see? Is you're this close to fighting? What do you think about
Wilson? Wilson's good. Oh, speak. They have fight chicken.
Yeah, they do.
Well, I see if they can make it just a chicken breast or something like that. So, sorry. Wilson Hayes is great. Good fighter. He's been in the sport for a very long time, fighting multiple weight classes. Great guy. I'm looking to get out there and fight him, see what he brings, you know? He always has good cardio, big for the weight class. Typically, you know, when I fight guys who are bigger than the weight class, I seem to, you know, it's always different when you fight someone who's going to push the pace, you know? We'll see.
What's your recovery like? Because obviously you guys were supposed to fight in August. So what exactly had happened, if you could remind people what happened?
Yeah, we were supposed to fight, was it July 30th? I think it was July.
Around there.
July 30th. I was training 3 weeks out from the fight, feeling best, feeling good. And I had a tear on my LCL, grade 2. And was doing anything normal. I was just putting a heel hook on somebody, and then I just push and pop. I then got PRP. They got stem cell. Then end up fighting, you know, Tim Elliott. He got injured in that fight in the first round. And then recovered from that.
What was that injury?
Popliteus tear. I thought I tore my right LCL. In the first round, he had me, and then he's so much longer than I was. So he was doing something, and then I felt a pop in my right knee. And I go, oh, man, I'm like, oh, there goes my right LCL. Perfect. And so fucked with that, got an MRI, and they're like, you had muscle strains in your right. Not strings, but popliteus. It's a muscle behind your calf. A lot of runners get it. So I recovered from that, trained for this fight, and then here we are now. Yeah.
All right. Thanks, guys.
That was
Yeah.
That was fucking weak.